Changing tack slightly. That's great. Yeah. We're going to continue our series on our church vision, of talking about hope, opportunity, and transformation. I'm going to talk a little bit more about hope today. Before that, but you've got to have a joke, haven't we? We've got to have a couple of jokes, just to sort of like... Two monkeys were getting in a bath. One got in and went, ooh, ah. The other said, well, just put some cold in then. No, yes. Okay, so some of you might have read this, because if you listen to the same podcast as me, last week I changed the sat-nav in my car to a male voice. Now all it says is, it's around here somewhere, just keep driving. Okay. Are you an optimist? I hope so. And one final one, I like this one, you'll have heard this. A friend suggested I put horse manure on my strawberries. I'm not doing that again, I'm going back to double cream. Anyway, yeah, you like that one, I like that one. Yeah, seven-year-old humour, it's great. Okay, we're going to continue our series on hope. And just to remind you here, we exist as a church to give hope, provide opportunity, and see transformation by God's powerful love. And we've reminded ourselves this morning during worship that God is a God who loves us. He is kind and he's good. And that's what we want to see take place in our lives. But we also want to be a community full of hope. Just to remind you, the definition we're using of hope is the joyful expectation of good. Anticipation? Expectation. Well, anyway, one of those words. It's the image of a bunch of children in a corridor on Christmas morning with a closed door in front of them, but they know that there's a Christmas tree and presents under the tree. They know something good is going to happen. That's the biblical definition of hope. It's not just a vain wish. And we want to be a hope-filled community. That's what we're here for, to give ourselves hope and to give others hope. That's what Jesus wants his church to be. I was reminded of a story I read. A favorite author of mine is Philip Yancey. I don't know if many people have read much Philip Yancey. He's a brilliant author. In his book, What's So Amazing About Grace, he tells a true story that his friend had told him. His friend worked in a very down-market part of a city, worked with all sorts of people with drug challenges and prostitution. And a prostitute came to his friend and said, basically burst into tears and was just apologetic. It turned out that she was renting her a toddler out for sex with men to support her drug habit. She was homeless, she was sick, she had no food, and she was desperate. And this guy didn't know what to say to her. He was so shocked. And he stumbled out eventually. He said, have you ever thought about going to a church for help? And he said, I'll never forget the look of pure shock on her face. Why would I ever go to a church? I was already feeling terrible about myself. They'd just make me feel worse. And I found that a very poignant story. So what are we going to be? Are we going to make people feel better when they're part of us? Or are we going to make them feel worse? Jesus describes the church as a city on a hill. It describes us as salt and light. We shine out to the countryside around us. That's what he wants us to be. Not full of ourselves, but full of the goodness of God and shining that out to others. This community, as we know, our lovely church family, we don't have to be polished and perfectionist and get everything right. But we do need to give glimmers of light to other people's lives. And I've been pondering, how do we communicate hope to others in this setting, in our daily lives, in our workplaces? How can we be people of hope? And so today I just want to read a summary of the church's first gathering in the New Testament. This is a loving and supportive and kind community. And this just taken place just after the day of Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit has absolutely wiped the church. 3,000 people become Christians. They're full of the life and goodness of God. And this is what happens. This is what they sound like. This is the church. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. And everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. And every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who are being saved. That's not a fairy tale. That's history of what the church looked like in the early days. And I think we can learn a few lessons from this, how we can learn what they did and how, therefore, we can be people of hope. And so I'm just going to go through four quick points. That's a community of hope. Firstly, they were a learning church. They were a group of people that took the apostles' teaching seriously. It says they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. The apostles were the leaders. They were the friends of Jesus. They were eyewitnesses of all that Jesus had done and said. And these people, therefore, devoted themselves to the teaching of Jesus. There was no sloppiness. They probably took notes on their iPads or scribbled it down. They really paid attention. They'd just had a supernatural encounter with the Spirit of God. They had repented. They'd turned away from their previous life. They'd got baptized. And now it was like God was putting the structure into their lives. They'd had an experience, but now the apostles were starting to teach foundational stuff into their lives. And you know, applying scripture or the words of the Bible to our lives, it works. It works if we take scripture seriously. It really does. I've been thinking a fair bit about mental health and worry at the moment. I know a number of folks really being affected by that. The outcome of the pandemic has really churned people up. Worry and anxiety is a big thing. And the scriptures say a lot about that. Corrie ten Boom, a famous Dutch lady and teacher, she said, "Worry is a cycle of inefficient thoughts whirring around a center of fear." And we can all get caught up in that, you know, can't we? We can worry about silly things. Billy Connolly, the great Scottish comedian, said, "Oh, you know, I worry about the strangest things. How does the guy that drives the snowplow, how does he get to work? You know, and I can spend days worrying about it." Yeah, thank you. Someone got the joke. Yeah, there you go. Anyway. But seriously, mental health is a really big problem. And we can worry and get anxious. But the scriptures, the teaching of Jesus, has the answer. And it's so important that we're people that meditate on those scriptures. You know, there's 1 Thessalonians talks about rejoice always. You know, give thanks continually. Pray all the time. You know, this is not just good advice. This is medicine for the soul. And if you're suffering with anxiety or worry, you need to get into the scriptures and see what it tells us to do. The power of focus. Last week, that dear girl, Molly Russell, there was her inquest 14-year-old girl who took her own life a few years ago. And from the inquest, it turns out that this poor girl who had clinical depression, she was 14 and struggling, in the previous 6 months, she had seen 2,000, more than 2,000 images of self-harm and suicide on Instagram. She was accessing Instagram 120 times a day, filling her minds with bad thoughts on top of the depression she was always feeling. Whatever we focus on grows. Whatever we worship gets bigger. And this church, the learning church, we're learning to focus on the right things, to focus on the goodness of God. Philippians says, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think on those things. So sometimes we have to be quite disciplined and turn our minds from what we're worrying about and turn them into positive things. You know, and we do that by reading the scriptures and meditating and chewing on them. Perhaps another more amusing anecdote. There's a scripture in the Bible that says, gifts turn away wrath. And that's in Proverbs. And I think I spoke a few years ago, we had some neighbor challenges. I was accused by my neighbor. She said, I would expect better from someone with your standing in the community. That made me feel really good. And I wanted to say to her, well, let's just come to church on Sunday. No. She was fairly upset because I was walking on her lawn. But we said, well, what should we do? So we got a bottle of wine and I wrote a very groveling card and I put it next door. I hope you're watching, by the way. But anyway, so we left it there. But the story continues. This week, I got a phone call from this lady and she said, I've got your dog. I've rescued your dog. My dog was at the top of Valley Road, and she'd actually stopped her car graciously, because she wasn't a dog lover. She'd stopped the car, and for about 10 or 15 minutes had held on to his collar while phoning me, while I ran away and ran around and got the car. And I thought, gifts turn away wrath. There had been, you know, it's just a silly little example, but if we do what the Bible tells us to do, it's good. So this was a church that was a learning church. They had been transformed by the Holy Spirit, but they're also being transformed by the Word of God. It's a loving church. They were devoted to one another. What I just read, the scripture, they devoted themselves to fellowship. That's the Greek word koinonia. That's, you know, gathering together, supporting one another. And that was in the context of being generous to each other. Because the scripture said all the believers were together and they had everything in common. They sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. So who wants to be a New Testament church today? Oh, very good. Okay. This is challenging stuff. You know what that says? They sold their houses, they sold things that they owned to give to others that were struggling financially. And over the centuries, the church has grappled with these scriptures. This isn't just something we go over in a minute. So what does it mean to be a Christian? Do I have to sell everything I've got? You know, and some people in Christian history have done that. They've said a vow of poverty, they've sold everything. And they've gone to live and work in a monastery. At the same time as Jesus was alive, there was a religious sect called the Essenes who lived in the desert. And you might have heard of them, but you would have heard of the Dead Sea Scrolls. These were the people that wrote the Dead Sea Scrolls. And they took a vow of poverty. They sold everything they had. He said, that's what it is to be a believer in God. I have to sell everything and give it all away. The Bible is full of good news. I don't think the Bible says that. Jesus actually only said that to one person, one young man who he knew had a problem with finances. He said, sell everything and go and follow me. But to the rest of us, Jesus says, be radically generous. Be radically generous. You don't have to sell everything. And in fact, we even here, they didn't sell everything. The people here still had houses because they ate bread and had fellowship together in their homes. So they still had homes. But it is a challenge. The scripture is a challenge. But they loved one another through giving generously. And we must be a generous people. There's something incredibly powerful about giving to others. You've always got something you can give. And we show our love with our wallets, with our time, with our energy. And we keep throwing this one out. How do we serve as a church? There's so many people in this church, wonderful, serving, volunteering. Do we serve with good hearts to bless others? If someone's forgotten to do something, do we just say, well, it doesn't matter, it's just an error, let's get on and do it, let's bless people? Do we serve with everything we've got? There was a wonderful story I heard a few years ago as a guy was talking about his family traditions. We've all got family traditions. In his family, the whole big family would get together and they'd have a big meal together, and his job from the day one was to peel the potatoes. And every year the family got together, he would have this big sack of potatoes that he'd have to peel. And he even got his own potato peeler, you know, because he was so, you know, into it. Really good quality potato peeler. And at the end of that time, I was listening to him doing his talk, he said, you know, I'm not passionate about peeling potatoes, but I am passionate about my family. And if we have that sort of heart and attitude, we may end up having to do things that aren't our number one ministry or, you know, the thing I feel called to do. But we're passionate about our loving family. Peter says, love one another deeply. That's the mark of a Christian. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, that you love one another. That is the mark of a Christian, that you love one another. And God puts us in a church to learn to love one another. And we're all so different. It's our nursery and training ground. You know, Joe and I, we really do love this church. And we hear all the time of little moments of generosity. We hear someone say, oh, someone really blessed me. Someone really helped me with that. And we hear these stories. And as you start giving generously to others, something beautiful happens and hope rises. And it actually inspires those people to be givers as well. And generosity is an overflow of what God is doing in our hearts. And it's catching. Thirdly, they were a worshipping church. It says they devoted themselves to the breaking of bread and prayer. Often breaking of bread, that phrase in the Bible, is used as just getting together and having a meal together. But here it's very clearly in a sort of worship context. They were praying and they were having communion together. And again, it was formal. They met in the temple courts. It was a formal gathering, like a Sunday morning. That's where they were worshipping together. But it was also really informal. And they would be in their homes. And, you know, it was relaxed. They would have communion over a cup of tea at home or just share time and space with each other. And there was a lot of joy around. And it was great last week. Some of you were here to hear Jonathan speak about hope. He said when he came in the room, he sensed joy in the room. And I thought, that was so nice to hear. We want to be a church that has a lot of joy. And I wonder if you could cue up a little video. I'm just going to show a couple of minutes of a video and maybe put the blinds down a bit, show it, if that's all right. But here's a vid. It might seem crazy what I'm about to sound. That'd be great. You know this song. few buttons being pressed. If you could go back to the beginning, that's great. Yeah. It's just the... put it up loud, please. It might seem crazy what I'm about to say. On, you can watch it on YouTube. We're drawing over 1 billion people have watched it. I'd like to be part of a church with that, and you need to tweak the delay on that as well next time, yeah? Because we couldn't, yeah, anyway, I'll talk to you about it. But I want to be part of a church that sings like that. Would that be good? We're all very okay, anyway. Happiness is good, but joy is better. We don't have to all be extroverts. Henri Nouwen says, joy is the experience of knowing that you are unconditionally loved by God and that nothing, sickness, failure, distress, oppression, war, or even death can take that love away. Joy is a choice. It's deep. So it was a joyful church. It was also very reverent. Everyone was filled with awe. Something was happening in that community that was shaking people to the very core. It wasn't safe, but it was loving. Nikki Gumbel says, I'll get onto that in a minute. Oh yeah, I will say that. It was awesome. But it was also prayerful. They said they were devoted to prayer. Nikki Gumbel says that the more I pray, well, as actually quotes an archbishop, the more I pray, the more I find that coincidences happen. You know, we need to be a prayerful people. And I was struck, we watched Alpha a couple of weeks ago, and it was all about prayer on the Alpha course. And they told a story about the Chilean miners, the 33 miners that got stuck 2 kilometers down in a mine. And it was completely hopeless. And it was a very, very moving testimony there. But I did a little bit more reading about that afterwards. And I heard that the chief drilling expert who was looking for them was a Catholic believer. He was an American guy that was flown in. And this is his testimony of what happened, his prayer. They'd been drilling for days. And he said, then, near the end, only 100 feet away from the miners, everything stopped. We were stuck, totally 100% stuck. It seemed it wasn't humanly possible to drill the hole. I felt completely defeated. I thought, I can't do this. Then it hit me, I don't have to do this. God's going to do this. He's going to carry it. And he thought back to his reading of Psalm 63 and prayed, I've done everything I can, Lord. This is your work. You're going to have to send your angels. And that is when the miracle happened. The drill moved again. Meter by meter, it kept moving until it reached the miners. It was God, Hall said. God drilled the hole. We just had a good seat. I think, isn't that great? Isn't that a wonderful way of talking about prayer? God is in this place. God is in this place. God is at work in our hearts. As you know, I was baptized there. I was married there. And I wonder if one day I'll be in a box here. Who knows? Not yet. Thank you. Amen.
Amen.
But this is a special place. I mean, I believe God is a God for the whole universe and world, but he does fill spaces. It's a special place for me. Anyway, thank you, Lord. So we must be a worshipping church, joy and awe. And finally, coming into land, a growing church. I find this fascinating because they were learning, they were loving, they were worshipping. And then it says, and the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. Yes, the people were doing lots of things, but it was actually the Lord that was adding in. They weren't fretting. They were just worshipping and loving and learning. And the Lord brought the people in. As we give ourselves wholeheartedly to God, God will bring the people in. And it's he who adds. And it's interesting that the people were added to the church and they were saved. What we don't want is Christians having an isolated, individualized faith where they cherry pick into church situations and not into loving families where they'll grow in maturity. We don't want isolated Christians. We want people to flourish and learn, and iron sharpens iron with each other in a loving family context. Salvation and church membership belong together. I've also realized recently that I'm not quite as serious at telling other people about Jesus as I should be. I'm fairly introverted. I'm not out there shouting, you need to be saved. But I do feel I need more courage in that area. And God's just putting his finger on me at the moment to say, look, if you believe this stuff, Jeremy, then it might be a wise idea to share that information with other people that might benefit from it. Some of you are natural evangelists. You do it just like how you breathe. Others of us have to learn. I just had a little incident about that this morning on the way to church. I was going past the loos, the lovely loos in Henley. Aren't they gorgeous? Have you ever been stuck in one of those? Yeah. No, anyway, someone has quite recently. Henley Standard front page news. But I saw a young man in there who was cleaning the loos. And I thought I might have recognized him. And Joe and I walked past and I said, I think that might have been XYZ. But I ignored it and walked on. But after Joe had left, I walked back about 100 yards and went to see. Because I thought, actually, I need to be a person of courage occasionally. Don't worry about being embarrassed, getting it wrong. Because I wave at people all the time in cars when I'm not wearing my glasses. Hi. So I had a little young chat with this young man. And I was so glad I'd turned around. And I want us to have that feeling in us, to turn around sometimes to people that we really should talk to and just say, just be interested in them. We need to be people of courage, and that will help the church grow. Later on in Acts, there's an amazing little passage. It says, the apostles performed many signs and wonders amongst the people, and all the believers used to meet together in Solomon's colonnade. No one else dared to join them, even though they were highly regarded by the people. Nevertheless, more and more men and women believed in the Lord and were added to their number. How does that work? On the one hand, in one sentence, it says, no one else dared to join them. And then one sentence later, it says, nevertheless, more and more people were joined. They believed in the Lord. Powerful, powerful stuff. God adds. as we give ourselves wholeheartedly to him. Many of us watched the funeral, the Queen's funeral. Justin Welby, Archbishop, said, "Christian hope means certain expectation of something not yet seen. Christ rose from the dead and offers life to all, abundant life now and life with God in eternity. As the Christmas carol says, where meek souls will receive him, still the dear Christ enters in. We will all face the merciful judgment of God." Not a popular line in today's culture, judgment, but each one of us will face the merciful judgment of God. We can all share the Queen's hope, which in life and death inspired her servant leadership. Service in life, hope in death. All who follow the Queen's example, inspiration of trust and faith in God, can with her say, "We will meet again." I want us to be people that share good news, kindly, honestly, courageously with others. There is a scripture in 1 Peter that says, we need to be ready to give people an answer when they ask us about our faith, about the hope that we have. Let's be people that do that. So as I finish, that's the church. The church, the learning, the loving, the worshipping, the growing church that we see in Acts. And wouldn't it be great if we follow in their footsteps? We are in so many ways, but I hope that I've thrown out a few challenges to us individually and as a church. What do we want people to see and touch and smell when they get involved with us? We want them to experience hope. First of all, I want each one of you to experience hope. We can be people, as this picture shows, this is just before the sun rises. There's people around us who can't see the sunrise. Everything's dark and dingy. But if you've got the hope of Christ in your heart, you can tell them that the sunrise is coming. Let's be people of hope today and a community of hope.